unless we end up having some time to discuss something else. So there are too many acronyms on the title, as you can see. TLP stands for Thread Level Parallelism, something we haven't yet talked about. We talked about ILP and MLP, that is Instruction Level Parallelism and Memory Level Parallelism. So Thread Level Parallelism essentially talks about extracting threads from a program and running them concurrently. So that's Thread Level Parallelism. And threads you can think of it as a bunch of instructions, a set of sequential instructions, or a portion of a sequential program. And of course, a thread comes with certain other constructs like a stack and other things. So we'll not talk about how to extract threads from a program, or you know, how really a processor accepts threads. So some mechanism which will generate the threads. All we'll talk about is how a processor can handle the threads efficiently. That's all. Yes.
So whenever the programmer, threads which are made by the programmer, specified by the programmer in some sort, are they mapped directly to the threads that are extracted by the processor?
No, processor doesn't extract any thread. Threads come from somewhere. Like, it could be handled by the programmer and then generated by the compiler. It could be automatically extracted by some software. Okay, so we'll not talk about any hardware that actually extracts threads. Okay. We'll start with threads. We'll assume that threads are already there. And we'll only talk about how to manage these threads optimally. Okay. HT stands for hyper-threading. I don't know, some of you might have heard about Intel HT processors. It's just a stylized name for simultaneous multi-threading. So this particular term was originally coined by some researchers in academia. Later, Intel modified that and named it hyper-threading. So we'll see the difference between what was actually proposed in academia and what was finally implemented in the processor. CMP stands for chip multiprocessor. This is another way of doing multi-threading on chip. And so we'll look at all these architectures. Okay. So let's start with SMT, which stands for simultaneous multi-threading. So here the basic goal is to run multiple threads at the same time. So I'd like to emphasize on the term same time, because whatever we have seen in the operating systems is essentially a multiplexer. So you run a thread at a time. And multiple threads are usually time multiplexed on the machine. Here we're talking about running multiple threads at the same time. Right? So it's slightly different. Which of course means that the hardware must have support to be able to do that. Otherwise it's impossible. So why is it helpful, or why should we even discuss these things? Because it helps in hiding large memory latency, because even if one thread is blocked due to a cache miss, it is still possible to schedule ready instructions from other threads without taking the overhead of context switch. So one fundamental property of these type of multi-threading is that there is nothing called a context switch. All the threads are active all the time. All you have to do is that you have to pick up instructions from ready threads and schedule them to our wake-up logic, and they will execute their code. Right? So it improves ultimately memory level parallelism, because it essentially allows you to send more memory requests. So while one thread has sent a request, we'll bring in one more thread, which will probably run for a while, send another memory request, go to sleep, bring in one more thread, and so on and so forth. Okay. And this is exactly what today's graphics processors actually exploit at a much larger scale. You'll find that today's GPUs, which stands for graphics processing units, if you look at the most recent GPUs coming out of the industry, they would have more than 1,000 such threads simultaneously. About 1,000. So we'll not be really talking about that scale of machines. We'll be talking about 4-8 threads, because the basic concept is more or less the same. Of course, scaling to 1,000 threads does require a certain amount of innovation, okay, because otherwise you'll be you'll be having many problems like scaling resources, meeting the power budget, and all those things. So we'll not get there. We'll limit ourselves to small number of threads and see what the basic concepts are. Okay. So overall, improves resource utilization enormously as compared to a superscalar processor. Because if you think about a superscalar processor, what it is doing is that it has a single thread running at a time. Right? And whenever the thread takes a cache miss, in the last level of the cache hierarchy, the instruction will eventually come to the top of the ROB, block everything, processor will stop for a long time. Resources will be mostly underutilized. And that's what is happening today in the superscalar processors. Here, what we're really doing is that we're trying to package many such superscalar processors into a single chip, right? In some way. Right? So it allows you to switch out one thread, which is having a cache miss, bring in another thread, and let it run while the cache miss gets resolved for the other thread. Okay. So latency of a particular thread may not improve. In fact, it may worsen a little. We'll discuss that why. Okay. But the overall throughput of the system increases. Because what you are doing is that every unit of time you will be completing more instructions. That's all you're doing. That is, average number of retired instructions per cycle increases. So there are three design choices for single core hardware multi-threading. Okay. So we're talking about just one processor. That's what the single core term stands for. And we want to do hardware multi-threading inside it. So that means I want to support multiple threads inside. So here are the three options. One is coarse grain multi-threading, which means you execute one thread at a time. When the running thread is blocked on a long latency event like cache miss, swap in a new thread. The swap can take place in hardware. So that means you need extra support and extra cycles for flushing the pipe and saving register values unless renamed registers remain pinned. Okay, so what it means is that if you're running a thread, so it takes a cache miss, okay, right? So currently, if you look at the register map snapshot, it has certain registers currently mapped. Okay? So the logical registers currently are having maps for physical registers. Okay? So now what you want to do is that you want to put this thread to sleep for some time until the cache miss resolves and bring in a new thread and run it. Right? So what are the things you need to do? Well, of course, you have to change the program counter because that's where the new thread will start running now, the program counter of that thread, whichever new thread you want to bring in. And you want to make sure that the registers which were used by the old thread are saved properly so that when that thread comes back, they can be restored. Now, this can be done in two ways. One is that you can naively just copy the registers into memory, all right? And then when you bring in the thread, you could copy the memory content back to the registers, all right? So that's what the operating system does. The other option is that you already have certain registers renamed. The logical registers of the thread are renamed to certain physical registers. You say that, well, these physical registers will remain allocated. They cannot be used by any other thread. So that actually obviates all saving mechanism. You don't have to do anything. Because you know that these register contents will not be touched by anybody. They will remain as they are when the thread comes back. And that's, again, exactly what today's GPUs exploit. They do not save any register on a context switch, which is why you find that the GPUs have tens of thousands of registers inside them. And this is the reason. They need it because they want to support thousands of threads. Okay, all right?
So, but we need to store the logical to physical register.
Yes, you have to save the map. That's right. Yes, unless, we'll actually look at that, unless we also support multiple map tables. Yes. So we'll see actually, this kind of processors would actually have multiple map tables. Yeah, but anyway, saving a map table is a small thing. So we're anyway doing checkpointing of map table, right? So why is it called coarse grain multi-threading? Because what we're doing is that we are really not mixing thread instructions at a very fine grain. We're letting one thread run at a time. The only thing is that in the operating system, we are doing a thread switch at a much coarser grain. That is, we're saying when a system call happens, you would switch a thread. Okay. Here we are actually going further and saying that, well, even on a cache miss, I'm going to switch a thread. Okay, right. So it's a very fine-grained thread switching, but we're still very close to what the operating system does. We're letting one thread run at a time. That's all. The next improvement is fine-grained multi-threading. That is, you fetch, decode, rename, issue, execute instructions from threads in a round-robin fashion. Okay. So what it means is that this cycle, I'll fetch, decode, rename, issue, execute instructions from thread 1. Next cycle, I'll fetch, decode, rename, issue, execute instructions from thread 2, and so on and so forth, and I'll cycle through the right threads. Okay, all right. So notice that here I'm not introducing any new resources though. I just have a single pipeline here also. Okay. I'm just switching the program counters to make sure what instruction gets injected in the pipeline. That's all. So maybe thread 1's instruction gets injected this cycle. Next cycle, thread 2's instruction will get injected. So every cycle, I'll be switching the program counter. Okay. So here, what's the problem? So it improves utilization across cycles, no doubt about this. So compared to this, right? So here, what may happen is that because of certain resource shortage, you may not be able to exploit the entire resources given to you. Okay. Here, we'll solve some of the problems. Because across cycles, the utilization of the resources will improve. But the problem remains within cycle. So within a single cycle, what may happen is that in a certain cycle, let's say the current cycle is given to thread 1. And you find that in this cycle, thread 1 has only two instructions to issue, but that can be issued, okay, two instructions already. But suppose the hardware has provided you with four issue slots. That means 50% of the issue slots will actually go waste. Also, if a thread gets blocked in a long latency event, its slots will go wasted for many cycles. Okay, because this is a static scheduling technique. You have said that if I have two threads, odd cycles will be given to thread 1, even cycles will be given to thread 2. So if thread 1 is currently taking a cache miss, all your odd cycles will go idle, okay, which is not a good thing, of course. Okay. So the third solution is called simultaneous multithreading. Here, what you do is you mix instructions from all threads every cycle. So what you do is that you first fetch from thread 1. You find that, well, I can fetch only two instructions this cycle because the third instruction of thread 1 is a branch instruction. So I don't know where to go. Okay. But suppose I have actually four instructions to fetch. So I'll probably fetch one instruction from thread 2 if the second one of thread 2 is a branch, and one more from thread 3 to fill up the fetch you know, packet. So every cycle, in every stage, I'll be doing that. I'll try to fill up my resources as much as possible by mixing instructions from all the threads. So that gives you maximum utilization of resources. And notice that in all these cases, I have no context switch. All right? So what are the problems? So it offers a processor that can deliver reasonably good multi-threaded performance with fine-grained fast communication through caches. Because now what is happening is that I can run a thread, subsequently another thread can share data with this thread through the cache memory. Okay? So communication becomes extremely fast. Although it's possible to design an SMT processor with small area increase, for example, we talked about Pentium 4 HT, which had only 5% extra area compared to Pentium 4. For good performance, it becomes necessary to rethink about resource allocation policies at various stages of the pipe. So we'll talk about some of the policies. Also, verifying an SMT processor is much harder than the basic underlying superscalar design, because essentially what you're doing is that as soon as you bring in two threads, you have to look at the cross product of the state space of the two threads. Okay, so it's an exponential blow up in the state space of the entire design. And that blows up very fast as you introduce threads. Okay. So you must think about various deadlock, live lock possibilities since the threads interact with each other through shared resources on a per cycle basis. For example, you have to think about, so these are the problems that the operating system designers actually think about. Okay, now the hardware designer will have to think about when you do this. Because what may happen is that a thread may hold a resource and some other thread may be waiting for a resource holding another resource. And then there will be a cycle of resources. Okay, right? You have seen all these things. So these things now will have to be resolved by the hardware. Okay. And so the other option that people started thinking about, in addition to this, was that why not exploit the transistors available today to just replicate existing superscalar cores and design a single chip multiprocessor. So why not, why do you want to do all these things and bring headache? You have already designed a nice processor, just replicate some of these on a single chip and you have a multiprocessor, right? So, and you have so many transistors. So that led to the concept of chip multiprocessor. And that's what you find in today's all processors. So it's essentially the name for multicores. That's what they're called actually, right? So in mid-90s, when the first paper on this thing came out from Stanford, they named it chip multiprocessor. So that's really the first name. So here is a list of things that happened in industry. It's no way exhaustive. It's just examples. So Intel's dual core Pentium 4, where each core was hyper threaded, actually. So you have actually multi threaded cores, okay, all right? And it uses just the existing cores. Intel's recent Sandy Bridge and Ivy Bridge, they have more cores on chip. For the server market, Intel has announced dual core Itanium 2, which was codenamed Montecito. Again, each core is two way threaded. AMD has released dual core Optera in 2005. Recent AMD processors have more cores. IBM released their first dual core processor Power 4 in 2001. We'll talk about Power 4 in a little bit. Next generation Power 5 also uses two cores, but each core is two way threaded. So we'll also talk about Power 5. Sun's UltraSpark 4, released in early 2004, is a dual core processor, integrates two UltraSpark 3 cores. So pretty much, you look at any chip manufacturer, they have gone this way. So let's see, what are the design problems here? So first of all, why do you need this? So one thing I have already hinted at, that is, you have transistors. Okay. So the question was that, how do you utilize these transistors? So today, microprocessor designers can afford to have a lot of transistors on the die. Like for example, if you look at the recent GPUs, they have more than a billion transistors. Okay. So a lot of transistors to use. And ever-shrinking feature size, as the transistor size is going down, leads to very dense stacking. So you can actually pack a lot of transistors. So what do you do with so many transistors? So one obvious solution that industry used for some time was that they invested a lot of transistors to caches, which of course helps up to some point. You can increase your cache size on chip. But beyond a point, what happens is that you really don't get the return for what you're investing. Natural choice was to think about a greater level of integration. Few chip designers decided to bring the memory and coherence controllers along with the router all the time. Okay. So one example was Compaq, for example. Their Alpha 21364 processor had everything on a single chip, memory controller, coherence controller, and the router. Okay. So what you could do is that you could just put the chip and the DRAM cards on a motherboard and you're done. Okay, that's a computer. You don't need any peripherals. The next obvious choice was to replicate the entire core. It's fairly simple. What you can do is just use the existing cores and connect them to a coherent internet. All right. So the cornerstone for all these things was Moore's law. How many of you have heard of this? Okay. So what it says is that the number of transistors on a die doubles every 18 to 24 months. So that means an exponential growth in available transistor count. If transistor utilization is constant, this would lead to exponential performance growth, but life is slightly more complicated. So some of you might have seen this as the Moore's law, that performance doubles every 18 to 24 months. That's not Moore's law. Okay, that assumes this thing, actually, that your transistor utilization is constant, which is actually not true. The problem is that wears don't scale with transistor technology, so wear delay becomes a bottleneck. So wear delay actually remains more or less constant, while transistors get faster. So communication becomes more costly. So short wears are good, which dictates a localized logic design. You don't want long wears with distributed logic and all these things, okay, right? But superscalar processors exercise a centralized control requiring long wears, because pretty much if you look at the issue queue, that controls everything. Okay. So your issue queue is the control, the central part, which decides what instruction will issue and what instruction will write to the register file, how will update the ROV and everything, right? So, in a pipeline, you might require wrong wears because of bypass and all those requirements. Okay. However, to utilize the transistors well, we need to overcome a memory wall problem. So this problem we talked about, this essentially talks about the problem that your processors most of the time stall waiting for data to come from memory. to hide memory latency, we need to extract more independent instructions, that is more instruction level parallelism. That's the only way to hide memory latency, because we said that what you can do is that if you have a cache miss pending for the instruction at the top of ROP, if you want to hide this entire latency, all you have to do is that during this entire time, you have to keep fetching useful instructions and executing useful instructions. So it essentially boils down to extracting more independent instructions, right? So, but that requires costly hardware. You need more in-flight instructions, because if you don't have more in-flight instructions, the probability of getting independent instructions is low. So, but for that, we need a bigger ROB, which in turn requires a bigger register file. Also, we need to have, bigger issue queues to be able to find more parallelism. None of these structures scale well, and the main problem is wiring. So, they require raw malwares. So, the best solution to utilize these transistors effectively with a low cost must not require long wires and must be able to leverage existing technology. So, CMP satisfies these goals exactly, which uses existing processors and invest transistors to have more of these on chip instead of trying to scale the existing processor to more wire. So multi-core was actually a natural choice. It didn't happen by accident. Industry was actually forced to move in this direction because of certain technology constraints. So here is a chart that shows, slightly dated actually. We are of course 2013 today. This one only shows up to Itanium 2. This is a chart of Intel processors. So what the point is that the y-axis is in log scale, x-axis is in linear scale, and this line is more or less linear. So that actually substantiates Moore's law. It's not totally linear, but more or less. So now, assuming that you have done this, you have put multiple processors on a single chip. But then didn't I just make my power consumption roughly n-fold by putting n cores on the die? Answer is yes. If you do not scale down the voltage or frequency. Okay. So usually chip multiprocessors are clocked at a lower frequency. You must have noticed this, that as the number of cores increases, normally the processor is clocked at a slower frequency. And the reason is actually this. Voltage scaling happens due to smaller process technology, because physics tells you that if I make a transistor smaller, I have to reduce the supply voltage as well. Otherwise, the transistor will break down. These are what the basic physics tells us. Right? So you have to scale down voltage. Okay, it cannot help. Now the physics tells us one more thing. That is, if you start reducing the voltage of a transistor, the electrons will move at a slower speed because the electric field goes up. The acceleration will be smaller. So which means, if you keep on clocking this transistor at a higher speed, there will be a fundamental problem in designing pipelines. What is that? So I have a pipeline. White chunks. So I have a pipeline. These are my pipeline resistors. And here I have certain logic. So this is the input, this is the output, right, etc. So what I'm doing is that I have scaled down the voltages of these transistors that implement the logic. But I continue clocking the transistors at a higher speed, which was happening previously. Is there any problem? So my clock goes here. This is combinational logic. There is no clock there. This is the clock. So supply voltage has gone down. I haven't brought down the clock frequency. And I said that if you bring down supply voltage, your electric field will go down, and your transistor will naturally operate at a slower rate. What will happen? Stages will not be complete. So even before this computation completes, I'll sample this latch, and I'll get a wrong value from the latch. Okay, all right. So that's the problem. So you have to bring down frequency for other reasons, but nonetheless, to keep your power consumption okay, you also have to lower the frequency. So overall, what happens is that you know that energy is CV squared from your basic physics, right? And power consumption is energy per unit time. So what you do is CV squared F is a power consumption, right? So what you get is, so voltage and frequency are more or less linearly related,
okay, over a certain range of operation.
So what you get is roughly a cubic dependence of power on voltage or frequency. That's what you roughly get. So which is good, because as your transistors shrink, you have to bring down the supply voltage automatically. You get a cubic saving in power consumption. Okay. So that actually helps here. This means that if you have n cores, you don't have to run them at a 1 minute clock, because you are gaining something here. But still, you will not be able to run it actually at the same clock rate. That can be proved. Okay. So anyway, so the point here is that when you are designing these multi-core processors, you cannot just look at performance. You have to look at power also. So what you do is that you change your metric. You talk about performance per watt. That's one thing that often people use, which is actually the same as reciprocal of energy. Right? Why? Because your performance is 1 over time, right? Because we say that if the time goes down, performance increases, right? Okay. So performance is 1 over time. So this is essentially time per watt, 1 over time per watt, which is reciprocal of energy. Okay. So this one actually tells you that if you have less energy, it's good. Okay. Right? So it's somewhat bad, because all you need to do is to optimize energy, which probably can be done by sacrificing performance. Okay. So a more general metric is performance to the power of k plus 1 over watt. So instead of energy, you can now talk about energy times time. Okay, that's often called energy delay product. For example, if you set k equal to 1, that's what you get. Right? Energy multiplied by execution time. Okay. If you set k equal to 2, you get energy times execution time squared, okay, right? So that will put different emphasis on energy and performance. And you need smarter techniques to further improve these metrics. For example, today all processors implement online voltage frequency scaling, which dynamically monitor your processor's performance and decide whether you need to run it at a full voltage, or I can actually scale it down and still have the same level of performance. Okay, right? And when you scale down voltage, you scale down frequency as well. So we'll not really discuss any of the algorithms that are used by dynamic voltage frequency scaling. If you're interested, I can give you some references. But the rough idea is that you dynamically monitor your processor's performance, try to establish a correlation between voltage frequency and performance, larger correlation over time, and actually apply it. And then continue the feedback loop. So in all the processors, we'll actually discuss one implementation of this, but not much of the algorithm actually, as such. Okay, so some of the basics about chip multiprocessor. The fundamental question is where to put the interconnect. So what is this interconnect? That connects the processors. Okay. I have multiple processors, I have to have some connection between the processors, right? So you do not want to access the interconnect too frequently, because these wires are slow. That was a fundamental reason why you want a shift from the long wire designs. Okay. So it probably does not make sense to have the L1 cache shared among the cores. So what you're saying is that so I have these cores here. Let's say we have 4 cores. And what is a core? It contains the pipeline for executing instructions. So first option talks about putting the interconnect here, connect the cores, and then put the cache hierarchy. You have L1, then maybe L2, then maybe L3, etc., etc. Right? So essentially what I'm saying is that I have a shared L1. Is this a good idea? The answer is no. because every load store instruction from every code will have to cross the interconnect.
Okay.
And that clearly defeats this whole purpose. We didn't want to access the interconnect too often. Alright? So it requires very high bandwidth and may necessitate redesign of the L1 cache and surrounding load store unit, which do not want to do, which we do not want to do, right? Because what you require is heavier number of ports on L1 cache so that you can grant access to all of them concurrently. Okay. So what people do is that they settle for private L1 L2 caches. So what means is that I need a private hierarchy here that can absorb most of the load store operations. Okay, all right. So what usually today people do is that they put L1 L2 here, so they distribute this. All right, so each core gets its private L1 and L2 caches, right? And you share the L3 cache on the other side of the interconnect. And you need a coherence protocol at L3 interface to keep the private L2 caches coherent. So what may happen is that there will be a variable X, which is residing in all the L2 caches here, all right? So if one of the cores write to that value of X, you tell the others so that the value has changed, all right? So that's called a coherence protocol. So one may use high-speed custom designed Snoopy bus connecting the L2 controllers, or may use a simple directory protocol. So let me explain this, what it means. So imagine that you have a variable X in the program, which is shared by all the processors.
Okay, so shared variable.
So let's suppose currently X is residing here and here, and the value is 2 bits of the variable X, right? So now your program says that C2 wants to write to the variable X. Okay, all right. So it will access L1, it will miss the cache. It will access L2, it will miss the cache. Access L3 will probably get, so let's assume that X is actually here also. Okay, so X will be here if you have an inclusive cache hierarchy. Okay, otherwise X may not be here. Alright? So C2 gets X and it caches here and here. Let's assume that it's an inclusive hierarchy. And generates a new value for X, which is 3. So here it is 2, this is 3, this is also 2. Okay, fine. So now what may happen is that, so this guy may want to write to X, all right? So it generates a store, which misses in L1, hits in L2, copies X here, generates a new value, which is 5. And I can keep on doing like this. Eventually, I can show you that all processors will have the variable X in different values, two different values. Okay. So now your entire system is out of coherence. There's a variable X. Everybody sees a new value of X. And your program is probably going to do something very wrong. So you need hardware support to make sure that when this write happens, so forget about this one. When this write happens, you have to tell these two guys that there's a new value being generated for X. You should be aware of it. Right? And there are two ways of doing that. One is called a Snoopy protocol. So what it does is that whenever X tries to access something from the shared L3 cache, it will launch the address of the variable on the bus. Everybody else will snoop the bus, pick up the address, and make a comparison of that address with all the addresses here. So essentially, not all the addresses, it will pick up the address, index into the L2 cache, and see if that particular cache block is present or not. And if it is present, and if the launched command was actually a write command, it would invalidate the blocks from here. Right? So in this case, these two guys will actually match and invalidate X from the cache. So that there will be always a unique modified value of X. Alright? Okay, so that guarantees this part. And this is now gone. But that doesn't really solve the whole problem. Subsequently, C0 may want to access X. If it goes and accesses X from here, it is still 2. Because we're assuming that it's a write-back cache. And this value will go to here only when C2 evicts the block from its hierarchy. Okay, all right. So you also have to make sure that whenever somebody tries to access a variable, it gets directed to the current owner of the particular variable. Okay. So in this case, what will happen is that when C0 tries to access X, you launch the address on the bus, everybody snoops. This guy will get a match and actually will generate the new value on the bus, which will be picked up by C0. Okay, so that's called a Snoopy protocol, which makes sure that your values are always coherent. Now here the problem is that if you have a large number of processors, you have to, whenever a write is generated, you have to tell everybody that somebody is writing to this particular variable. So that requires a broadcast to everyone. That may flood your network, may generate a lot of messages. But here, what we really want to do is, we just want to tell these two guys. Because others don't care. Because others don't have this variable in their cache. So what you could do is that you could maintain a directory somewhere in the system, which this guy will go and look up and figure out that, oh, only C0 and C3 are the processors that are currently caching this variable. And it will send two point-to-point messages to these two guys saying that, we'll get the cache. I'm generating a new value. Right? So that's called a directory protocol. So I'll not go into much more detail about these protocols. There are many things that you can do to optimize these protocols, but this is the basic thing that you require, and this is called a coherence protocol. An entirely different design choice is not to share the cache hierarchy at all. Okay. So what you could do is that you could pull L3 up also here. Okay. So nothing stops you from designing one such architecture where each processor also has L3. And then the interconnect is here. So there is nothing shared. Alright. So early dual core AMD and Intel actually did this. It reads you of the on-chip coherence protocol because you really don't need anything. Okay. But no gain in the communication latency. Previously, what you could do is that you could share certain variables through L3 cache very fast. C0 could write something and write it back to L3. C3 could consume that through L3. Okay. Now you have to go through the interconnect. Go all the way up to get the back. Okay. So anyway, today you will probably not find any such architecture that has a complete private hierarchy. The last level of the cache is always shared. Okay.
So there would be a coherent protocol in this.
Yes, in this also.
It is not on chip.
It is not on chip, yes, exactly. Because normally this particular interconnect will be outside the chip. So this will be the chip. Okay. And this protocol will keep the L3s coherent. So if you do have a shared last level cache, it has to be banked. We have talked about that already, why you have to ban the caches. Because otherwise it increases latency. So then you have to talk about how many coherence engines per bank. That is, because each bank can receive a large number of coherence requests at the same time. So having more engines may actually speed up your coherence processing. Now, the question is that if you have a banked architecture, so let me have the L3s shared again. And let's suppose that this is actually a banked L3 cache. Okay, maybe it has four banks. So now, when you put an address on the bus, it may happen that nobody responds because nobody has the cache block. Okay. right? So then maybe one of the L3 banks actually has the cache buffer. It will have to respond. So the cache, so the particular bank that holds the cache block is called the home bank of the cache block. And that's normally a static mapping. So you say that. So it's a simple hash function which takes the address and figures out the home bank ID. Alright? So it's just a partitioning of your addresses across the banks. Okay. And a miss in the home bank means that the block is not inside the chip. You have to go to memory to bring the block because of intrusion. So this one we have already talked about, snoop or directory, the trade-offs and all. Snoop requires more bandwidth, directory doesn't require, but directory requires extra storage to remember who has the block. Now, is there any incentive of changing the home bank at runtime? I just said that it's normally a static. Is there any reason why I might want to change the home bank of a cache block? Yes?
So the cache blocks which are stationed in that bank are being heavily used by a processor.
Huh.
And the latency of accessing that cache for that particular processor is very high. So
right, exactly. So if we have an interconnect which is such that, so let me show you one example. Let's suppose that you have a ring, okay, right? And so I'm just showing, you know, this is a logical diagram. Of course, these drops will be distributed over the ring, all right? So on the other side, also things will be there. So let's assume that each ring stop has a bank of L3. So you have a four bank L3, and banks are distributed like this. Now, C0 finds that it needs a particular cache block whose home is here. Okay, and let's suppose that C0 is unable to cache this block very efficiently. It misses its L1 and L2 very frequently on this particular block. Okay. So then it makes sense actually to change the home bank from here to here. But this can only be done dynamically after monitoring the access pattern. So there are proposals which actually does this. You can do dynamic migration at the drain of a cache block. If you can figure out that a particular page is actually going through the same access pattern, which often happens actually because of spatial mapping, you can move the entire page, you can change all the home of all the cache blocks in that page from here to here. Okay, alright. So anyway, I'm not going to detail all these again. Now SMT and CMP add a couple more levels in hierarchical multiprocessor design. So what may happen now is that if you can take this particular architecture and say that, well, each core now has several threads running, okay, right? So I have these are all SMT cores. Okay. So if you just have an SMT processor, that is, suppose you have only this much, okay, or maybe this and this with L1 and L2, right? Among the threads, you can do shared memory multiprocessing with possibly the fastest communication. Why? Because this thread writes something to L1, the other thread may consume directly from L1. Okay. So it's a very fast communication between threads. You can connect the SMT processors to build an SMP over a Snoopy bus. So like this, for example, I've connected four SMT cores over a Snoopy bus. Okay. Here it's a ring, it could be a bus also. Okay. And you can connect these SMP nodes over a network with a directory protocol. So nothing stops me from taking this whole thing and connecting, you know, a few of these over a network, right? So I get a pretty large multiprocessor. For example, one single node gives me 16 threads. If I connect just four of these, I get 64 threads. You could do the same thing with CMP. Only difference is that you need to design the on-chip coherence logic, okay, which is not automatically enforced as in SMP. So notice that in SMP, I don't need any coherence protocol because this level itself is shared, the first level itself. Okay. If you have a CMP with each core being an SMT, like this, then you really have a tall hierarchy of shared memory. The communication becomes costlier as you go up the hierarchy. Okay, right? So as you go up, it becomes more and more costly because it takes time. Also, communication becomes very much non-uniform, as we've already pointed out. Okay, right? So here your compiler can do a very good job in actually producing good locality. Okay. So this is where your compiler can play a big role actually in optimizing your program to figure out in what phases what you need and so that you can proactively generate prefetch instructions to bring those. So most designs support SMT cores on a multi-core die like that. Okay. We'll talk about these five, that's why I have, sorry, these three, that's why I have listed these three. Also, we'll talk about two SMT case studies, that is Intel Pentium 4 hyper-threading and Compaq V8. So this one is actually 21464. We talked about 21264. This particular processor got canceled immediately because that's exactly when Compaq got bought by HP and Intel. And we'll discuss these four. Oh, I have IBM Power4 also in this. So I'm going to stop here today.